So next up, we have Dr. Troy Stapleton. A few months back, we had an Inspired Living event screening of serial killers, and we were really lucky to have Troy come along and speak there, and he was just amazing, so we're really going to love seeing him today. And he's going to speak about low carb, high fat for diabetes type 1 and type 2. Thank you.
Thank you, Leah. I've given this a similar presentation just down in Launceston, and we had a great crowd there, so hopefully I can, hopefully you'll enjoy it as much as well. Firstly, I always like to declare my conflicts of interest. I have no conflicts of interest. I actually put this one up for Gary Fedke because Gary's doing a great job down in Tasmania, and he's just launched a clinic using low carb, high fat. And Gary didn't actually know, but Frederick Banting, who's a Canadian, was actually an orthopaedic surgeon as well. So it's interesting to have a couple of orthopaedic surgeons who you're going to make a big difference in diabetes. This was a quote in the New York Times when they first started administering insulin to children. With insulin, dying children laughed and played again as parents wept and doctors spoke of biblical resurrections. And so insulin is obviously very important. It's life-saving for type 1 diabetics. And I'm still, obviously, I still need insulin, but it's life support rather than, it doesn't cure it, obviously. Always like to answer this question. I was read a book once that said, if there's an elephant in the room, you should introduce it. So this is my elephant. Why is a radiologist speaking about nutrition? And to answer that question, I need to talk through my story. So I'm a medical specialist, a radiologist, which means I interpret medical imaging, CAT scans, MRIs, ultrasounds. I graduated 20 years ago from medical school. And 2 years ago, I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. Type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune condition where the body attacks the islet cells which create insulin. And without insulin, it's a fatal condition. And until the discovery of insulin in the 1920s, if I had been diagnosed back then, I would have died. I went off to the clinic and was given the standard dietary advice, which I'm going to discuss, which I followed very rigidly for 2 months. But I've now changed to a low carbohydrate, high healthy fat diet. I've missed out the F there, I'm sorry. So the dietary advice that I was given, there was a picture of the food pyramid up on the wall. I was advised to have 45 to 60 grams of carbohydrate with each meal, to have a couple of snacks a day, 15 to 30 grams, and if you add up that's a total carbohydrate load of 240 grams per day. And then I was told to bolus insulin to cover those dietary carbohydrates. So type 1 diabetics have two insulins. They have a basal dose of insulin, which covers your background requirements. And then with each meal, you have to bolus insulin to cover the carbohydrates and the glucose rise that goes with that meal. And if you go to the Diabetes Australia website, that is broadly in line with what they recommend. It says to help manage your diabetes, they need to be regular and spread evenly throughout the day, lower in fat, particularly saturated fat, and based on high fiber carbohydrate foods such as whole grain breaded cereals, beans, lentils, vegetables, and fruit. So the advice sort of runs a little bit like this. You sort of estimate the carbohydrates in your meal, and then when you have that meal, you match that with a dose of insulin. The problem with it is it's actually very, very difficult to do that because there can be about a 50% error in the estimation of carbohydrates. There's obviously differences in gastric emptying and gastric absorption, and there's also up to 30% error in the dose of insulin as it comes in. And so when you add up all those variables, what they're asking you to do is actually impossible to get right every time. And so more often than not, you'll either go high after a meal or alternatively go low. And so following this advice, and I was, you know, one of the criticisms that I've had from dietitians, etc., is that, oh, Troy, you're so disciplined, you know, you achieve these great results, but no one else would. Well, I was disciplined on their advice as well. I haven't changed. And this is me being really, really disciplined and taking their advice, you know, eating whole grain breads, doing everything I could right. So a normal blood glucose, you can see those blood glucose measures there. A normal fasting blood glucose would be between 3 and 6, and a normal after meal blood glucose would be between 4 and 8. And so this is my graph. I was averaging blood glucose at 7.8. I was having daily spikes over 7.5. I was having weekly hypos, and my insulin dose was 24 units. So a hypo is when your blood glucose goes low and you can feel faint and you can collapse and have seizures and you can die. But I was having those once a week, and this was considered excellent control. In fact, when I went back to the clinic with these results, the response I was given was, wow, this is fantastic. For someone who's newly diagnosed, this is a great result. My HbA1c would have been under 7. I read a book, I did a lot of reading, and I read a book by Jenny Rule, and it talked about if you wanted to completely avoid the complications of diabetes, I'm going to talk about those shortly, you run your HbA1c, which is a measurement of your average blood glucose for the preceding 3 months, to be in the 5% range. You want your fasting blood glucose to be under 5.5, and your postprandial, that's post-meal, glucose to be under 7.8. If you actually look at true normal ranges, the HbA1c would be about 5% or lower, fasting glucose at 4.8, and postprandial is under 6.6. And I was desperate to avoid the complications. If we look at the American Diabetes Association guidelines, now I want you to try and follow the logic here, okay? This is a slide from, so your digestive system turns carbohydrates into sugar quickly and easily. I agree with that, I get that. Carbohydrates is the food that most influences your blood glucose levels. I agree with that, I get that. The more carbs you eat, the higher your blood glucose goes. Okay, that makes sense. The higher your blood glucose, the more insulin you need to move sugar into your cells, okay? The food pyramid is an easy way to remember the healthiest way to eat. At the bottom of the pyramid are bread, rice, cereal, and pasta. These foods contain mostly carbohydrates. You need to eat 6 to 8 servings of those a day. That's where they lose me. How can it be that a high carbohydrate diet is used to treat a disease of abnormal carbohydrate metabolism? So I read these books, Dr. Bernstein's Diabetes Solution. I highly recommend that if anyone has diabetes. Jenny Rule's Blood Sugar 101. And if anyone is interested in weight loss and how we ended up with the terrible advice we're currently given, then I highly recommend Gary Taubes' book. Good Calories, Bad Calories is also by Gary Taubes. This one is a little bit easier probably to read than that one. So what do the nutritional guidelines profess for diabetics? So it says carbohydrates are the essential energy nutrient in the modern diet and should provide at least 60% of the daily energy intake in humans at all ages. But humans have no essential requirement for carbohydrates. There's no known human carbohydrate deficiency disease. And so why should those who are intolerant of carbohydrates be encouraged to ingest the very nutrient that they cannot metabolize? So having done all this reading and research, and during my 2 months post-diagnosis, I was, you know, staying up into the wee small hours, and I was reading scientific journal articles, and I was reading books and internet sites, and I decided that it didn't make sense. And so I switched to what I call the real food pyramid, which are these foods, which is a low carbohydrate, high healthy fat diet, real food. I ate these foods, lots of salads, lots of green leafy vegetables, no fear of fat, so fatty cuts of meat are okay, olive oil's okay, butter's okay, these foods, lots of eggs, nuts, and so I cut out these foods. Now I know people find the fruit a bit confronting, but for someone who has carbohydrate intolerance, the fruit will spike their sugars and make them difficult to control. And there's nothing in these foods there's no nutrients that you won't get from green leafy vegetables. During our evolutionary period, we would not have eaten the super sweet fruits we now have all year long. And we would not have eaten tropical fruits in any significant amounts. So a switch, basically the diet is a switch from grains and carbohydrate-based foods and processed foods to vegetables, but with no fear of healthy fats. And so this is 2 years later now. In fact, this is the graph on your right, which everyone's going, wow, that looks really good. That's actually a bad week. I actually do a lot better than that sometimes, but this was the week that I was preparing this slide for you. So this is the graph now. My average BSL is now 5. My insulin dose is now 10, and I very rarely have hypos, maybe once every 3 months, maybe once every 6 months. We need to understand that our mitochondria, which is basically the powerhouse of our cells, are a hybrid engine. They can run on glucose as a fuel, they can run on fat as a fuel. And it does take the body a while to switch over to being able to utilise fat as a fuel source, but fat is an excellent fuel source. In terms of, now I'm no cyclist, and there might be a few cyclists in the audience who are giggling at these times, but that's okay. I've got data. So from 2009, a couple of friends and I, these are my two friends from uni, we decided that, you know, we're in our 40s, we would do the Noosa Triathlon as a team, and we would get together every year, and it would sort of give us the opportunity to catch up, and also to sort of get a bit fit once a year. And so these are my cycling times. Now this is pre-diagnosis, so 126, 123, 122. I had 1 year off because I was diagnosed with diabetes 6 weeks before the Noosa Triathlon, and then back doing it. So this year was my fastest time. I did that with no carbs. I had scrambled eggs for breakfast, and I had no carbs for the ride, which is, that was purely burning fat as a fuel. In fact, I've got faster rather than slower. So 24 months post-diagnosis now, 10 units of long-acting at night. I'm down from 12, so the long-acting insulin, the basal insulin dose doesn't actually change much. I do have occasional short-acting insulin, and it's likely that as, you know, over the years I may need to have more, I may need to bolus some short-acting insulin for protein, but at the moment I'm getting away with not. And what typically happens when a type 1 diabetic adapts to a low-carb, high-fat diet is that their insulin dose reduces, and most of the reduction is in the short-acting insulin. My HbA1c is 5. Now, to put that in context, the normal non-diabetic range is 4.3 to 5.5. So my HbA1c is in the smack bang of the middle of the normal non-diabetic range. Most doctors will aim to have their patients with a HbA1c under 7, which is actually twice, that means their blood glucose levels would be twice normal. I rarely go over 7.5, I rarely have hypoglycemic episodes. My triglycerides are down, my HDL levels are up in terms of my blood lipids, so an improved profile. My blood pressure is lower, in fact it's lower than it was 20 years ago. My weight is low and stable, and I'm back surfing and cycling. So I like to ask this question. Why would you recommend to someone who can't metabolise carbohydrates that they require them? So that's the first part of my talk, and I sort of split it into two parts. I mean, there wouldn't be many patients with type 1 diabetes in the crowd, but so that's my story, and why after all this reading I'm happy to speak about it. But in broader terms, I'd like to talk a little bit now about why as a society we've become fat and sick, and we've got metabolic syndrome and obesity and type 2 diabetes. So our children have become overweight, our dogs have become overweight, people engaging in physical activity become overweight, and you know, if Michelangelo were to carve David, he might look a little bit more like he does on the right rather than on the left. So what's happened? So the low-fat guidelines were introduced in the 80s, and this is what's happened to our obesity rates. Now this is association, this is not causation, so we could graph a whole bunch of stuff that changed in the 80s, and you could argue that that's why people are obese. And one of the other messages I like to promote, you know, Jimmy was talking about, you know, there's a study, you know, 1 minute they say coffee's bad, then they say it's good, then they say, you know, wine's good, then it's bad, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And the problem with a lot of those studies is that they're associational studies. And so when you see those headlines in the media, I want you to read them and to try and figure out what sort of study they are. And you'll find that they're mostly associational studies. And I'll give you an example of an associational study and how dangerous they are. So there's what an association study is they ask a bunch of people what they eat, and then they ask another bunch of people and they compare disease rates. So there's a very close association, for example, between shoe size and reading ability, okay? Now I want you to think about that for a moment. Because when you see someone with big shoes, you don't go, wow, that guy can read. It's just that, you know, my five-year-old has a small shoe size and he also doesn't read very well yet. So you can see that there are confounders, and you can spot that confounder easily, but a lot of the time in nutritional studies, it's hard to spot the confounders. And so if we're searching for truth, the sort of studies we should be looking at a lot are the randomised controlled trials. And that's where you take two groups, you match them as closely as you can, you change one thing, and then you watch and see what happens. So what's happening to the global prevalence of type 2 diabetes? Well, it's exploding. And if we don't do something to fix it, it's going to bankrupt us. is going to bankrupt us because of the long-term complications of diabetes. Nerve damage, vision damage, kidney damage, heart attack, stroke, peripheral vascular disease, infections, dementia, and increased cancer risk. I talked a little bit before about the HbA1c, which is a measurement of your average glucose. And you can see for every 1% reduction in HbA1c, you get a 14% reduction in fatal and non-fatal cardiac heart attacks. And for every 1% reduction in HbA1c for the microvascular complications such as diabetic retinopathy, which is the blindness that goes with diabetes, and also nephropathy, which is the renal failure, then you get a markedly improved result. Now, we talked about randomised controlled trials. Now, some might think, well, you know, come on, we must be on some pretty solid evidence. You were told to eat the food pyramid, you were told to eat grains and reduce your fat. You know, they must have some evidence, those guys, to recommend that. Well, in fact, they don't. When they finally got around to doing a proper randomised controlled trial, so those low-fat guidelines introduced in the 90 days weren't done so with any solid evidence behind them, and there were a number of scientists at the time that argued that a massive experiment was being conducted. Anyway, so they did Women's Health Initiative, was a $700 million study. And what they did was they took two groups of women and they gave one a lot of education to drop their fat intake, to increase their vegetables, fruits and grains, and basically prescribe to them the prudent diet. And the other arm of the trial, they just left to the toxic Western diet that most people are on. And they thought, this is going to be a smash down, we're going to kill this. And what did they find? They found that that did not significantly reduce the risk of coronary artery disease, stroke or cardiovascular disease. In fact, in women who had diagnosed cardiovascular disease at the start of the trial, who adopted the healthy heart diet, it increased their risk of future complications. And if you were diabetic, it worsened your control. This is a complete disaster. This is proof that the current prudent diet does not work. And instead of, you know, so the outcome of that, you would think people would go, we're on the wrong track. We've been giving really bad advice. In fact, they didn't. They blamed the patients. And they said, you know, maybe they weren't following our great advice. And you would never get away with that in a drug intervention trial. You would never. You would never get away with saying, oh, well, you know, maybe the patients didn't take it. But that's what they do with dietary trials. So what's the solution? We've talked about the problem. Diabetes is exploding, obesity is exploding, and there's all these complications. Well, we've got to change our thinking. We've got to try and figure out what's causing the problem. And what's the root cause of the problem? I think we need to think about our evolutionary history. And I use our evolutionary history to inform all of my thoughts in this process. And it's really funny because in every other field of medicine that I've been involved in, when you talk about evolution, people go, yeah, evolution, yeah, that's where we got to go, that's where we always start. But when you talk about evolution in nutrition, people think you're crazy, or you know, you're a quack or something crazy. It's quite odd. It's not true science. This is the current model that you'll often hear, the calories out, calories in, calories out, the sort of, you know, people are, it's simple, it's just eat less and move more. You know, all of this is the biochemical pathways of humans, and so they just ignore that as though it's irrelevant. And it's a brainless model, an absolutely brainless model, and it does not work because the different foods you eat changes the way they react with the body biochemically are important. And so when you eat foods that satisfy you and make you feel full, of course that's going to make a difference to the outcome compared to eating foods that spike your insulin and make you feel hungry. So this is the other hypothesis for heart disease, and this is what I believe is the current scenario which is driving the heart disease, the obesity and the type 2 diabetes. We're eating a high carbohydrate diet, and in the presence of insulin resistance, which about 60% of the community will have, that will cause the following. It will cause elevated glucose, elevated insulin, elevated triglycerides, low HDL, the small dense LDL particles, which are the ones that truly cause the heart disease, increased uric acid, increased inflammation, which is a CRP, and fatty liver. And we end up with this picture of arterial inflammation, of the metabolic syndrome, which is characterized by the high glucose, the high insulin levels, the high triglycerides, high HDL. We also end up with obesity, diabetes, and hypertension. And the solution to it is to cut the high carbohydrate diet. It's the only intervention that addresses all of the risk factors and is the single most important intervention in the management of coronary heart disease and diabetes, is to reduce the amount of carbohydrates in the diet. Now, this is the father of insulin resistance is a man called Gerald Raven, and he this is heavily published in the current literature. And so he proposed this that there's insulin resistance, and as I said, the high carbohydrate diet leads to the insulin resistance, and also there's the genetic susceptibility, that you then get compensatory hyperinsulinemia, that because you need more insulin basically to do the same job. That leads to the metabolic syndrome, which is also sometimes known as syndrome X, coronary heart disease. If the body can't make enough insulin, it'll lead to type 2 diabetes, which can also lead to coronary heart disease. So how can we intervene in this? This compensatory hyperinsulinemia gives you all these problems: the weight gain, the visceral adiposity, so you get the sort of pot belly, the high blood pressure, the high uric acid levels, impaired exercise performance. And this is the place to intervene. It's to stop, if we can cut out that high carbohydrate diet, even in the presence of insulin resistance, we won't get the compensatory hyperinsulinemia. And so you can put these conditions into remission. You don't cure them, you'll always have the insulin resistance, but if you can cut out the high carbohydrate diet, you stop this pathway. And so a balanced diet must minimise the insulin secretion at all times in those with insulin resistance. And so this is the model, again, Professor Tim Noakes has kindly allowed me to use some of his slides. So we've got these conditions: the atherogenic dyslipidemia, hypertension, obesity, gout, and type 2 diabetes. And these are the conditions that our local doctors are seeing, and they're treating them. They're treating the type 2 diabetes with medications to lower blood glucose. They're treating the gout. They're trying to treat the obesity. They're trying to treat the high blood pressure. But floating below the surface is the insulin resistance. And that's the problem. That's what we need to be looking at. And we need a diet that then allows us to treat that insulin resistance by preventing the high glucose levels, the high insulin levels, sorry. And that's a low-carbohydrate diet. If we look at what the aims for diabetes treatment are, we want to normalise blood sugar, we want to minimise low blood sugar, because we don't want patients going hypoglycemic, and then we want to correct these things. The bad lipids causing the narrowing of the blood vessels, we want to reduce inflammation, we want to allow them to exercise, we want to minimise their medications, and we want to try and reduce their weight and waist circumference. And a low-carbohydrate, high-fat diet will do all of these things. It lowers and stabilises blood glucose, it lowers blood pressure, it lowers triglycerides, it elevates HDL, it allows weight reduction, and it reduces these small, dense LDL particles. So now I've presented with you a number of claims, but I need to come up, obviously, with some evidence for those claims. And there are some trials which prove what I'm saying. Small trial in type 1 diabetics. Basically took just 48 patients with type 1 diabetes and elevated HbA1cs, offered them educational sessions using a carbohydrate-restricted diet, and followed them for 72 months. 50% of their patients adhered. And this is what they showed. They had these blood glucose levels pre and post, they had these levels, which are pretty much match exactly what my results. So that the adherent group, they dropped their HbA1cs from around 8% down into the mid-6s. Okay, the partially adherent, similar, and the non-adherent, they dropped and then they drifted off again. So these are obviously the group that I'm most interested in. So they reduced their HbA1c by 1.3%. Their mealtime insulin, they dropped from 23 to 13. This is really big for me. Their symptomatic hypoglycemic episodes dropped by 82%. They elevated their HDL and their blood lipid profile improved. So everything got better. Now there's actually a group of patients with families and patients with type 1 diabetes on the internet called type 1 grit. This is the general type 1 diabetic population. These are the HbA1cs there. Averaging, you can see the average is probably about 7.8 or so, and this is using a very low carbohydrate, high fat diet. These are the HbA1cs they're achieving. Again, a similar graph. Now it's a bit complex, this one, but this yellow line is the 50% centile line, so that's saying that 50% of type 1 diabetics will sit above this line and 50% below, and this is where the low carb, high fat group is sitting, right down here, under miles underneath the 10th centile line. In type 2 diabetics, this was just published this year, 2014. It was published out of our own CSIRO. took a bunch of patients with type 2 diabetes and randomised them. Remember I said about the difference between a randomised trial and an observational trial? So they'll randomise either to a low-carbohydrate diet or a high-carbohydrate diet, and they measured their HbA1c, their glycemic variability, the medications they're on, their blood lipids. And completion rates were similar. So one of the common criticisms you'll see in the media is they'll say, oh, look, you know, yeah, it's a fad diet and it's really hard to stick to. Well, have a look at that. It's exactly the same. So their diet that they recommend, you know, if they're going to make that claim against low-carb, high-fat, then you can't make that claim without also saying that their recommendation also doesn't stick to. So weight loss was similar, fasting glucose was similar, LDL was similar, but greater reductions in HbA1c, greater reductions in glycemic variability, able to reduce their medications and reduce that, and their trigs were down and their HDL was up. So again, a great result, and that's a randomised controlled trial. This was just published in Annals of Internal Medicine. Again, a randomised trial, took 148 men and women. This is without diabetes but were overweight. They randomised them to the low-carbohydrate group or a low-fat group, and they both received dietary counselling at regular intervals. And which one won? Well, no surprises. The low-carb group wins again. Greater reductions in weight, fat mass, blood lipid profile, triglycerides down, and HDL up. So these are strong. This is strong scientific evidence showing that a low-carbohydrate, high-fat diet is beneficial in these patient groups. And so what we eat is really important, and it's not just calories in, calories out. True health care begins in your kitchen. It's about preparing food, and I loved that talk that Leo gave earlier about mindful eating and, you know, growing your own food, preparing your own food, teaching your children the sort of foods that they should be eating, and vegetables obviously play a large part in that. And this, my other quote I like to say is that those who say it cannot be done, because we see a lot of that, oh, it can't be done, it's too hard. Well, they shouldn't interrupt those of us who are doing it. Thank you very much.